Our next panel, Performance Art of the Tawaifs and Baijis, will feature two doyens from the twin worlds of Indian music and dance who have come together to shed light on the performative aspects of the allegorical and real identity of the courtesan. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome singer and composer Shubha Mudgal, Kathak dancer and founder of the Sufi Kathak Foundation, Manjari Chaturvedi, who will be in conversation with journalist, author, and columnist Malvika Sanghvi.
Good afternoon, Shubhaji. Good afternoon, Manjari ji. What an honor and a pleasure it is to have two doyens of the performing arts, both strong, vibrant women at the top of their game together on one stage. Has this ever happened before? Have you all collaborated before on any stage? Oh. As I explained to them, I took this responsibility as an opportunity to learn more about the subject of tawaifs, I'm going to ask questions which not only need to be asked, but which I really wanted to know about. So we will open this up to questions towards the last 15 minutes. But just to set things off, we'll have a general talk about, first of all, Manjari, when did the Tawaif culture start in India? And what were the conditions that contributed to its start?
See, if we talk about the start of the Tawaif culture, I guess we could go back to the times of Lord Buddha and Amrapali, and you know, we go back to, because they were the courtesans. The word Tawaif as such was a very Avadh-centric word, and like if you see Banaras and Calcutta, they were known as Baiji. So, dance and music has been in our Indian culture from the time immemorial. If we say Raja Indra ke darbar mein jo nachte the, bhai, wo bhi to nachte the, Raja ke darbar mein.
So they were also courtesans. So that is time immemorial. But what we are, you know, kind of focusing as what we say about the Tawaif today, as we understand, is largely a phenomenon, if I may say, from 16th to about 20th century, if I'm not wrong.
16th to 20th century, the grand century.
You know, largely attribute to the Tawaif and Baijis. And that existed as an entertainment scene in India, where, you know, we have a very strong music and dance culture, which exists as part of our own traditions. Now, that is a different thing, whether it is performed by men or women, that's the secondary thing, but the tradition of music and dance are very strong, valued traditions here in India.
So how did it coalesce around female performers and this whole thing of patronage by courts? When did that all happen? When did that reach its zenith?
See, arts has always been patronized by, you know, somebody. So usually earlier it was all the kings that patronized. Today we, I would like to say it, but today we expect the
government to patronize it
because they are the rulers. So no longer the sevaks, but they are the rulers. So in those times it was patronized by the rulers themselves. And the patronage came, and that in a way molded the art also, because somehow you always see that, you know, if the patron is, what is the patron looking at? Supposing even today if we are performing in Chennai for our audience, we will slightly alter our concert to suit the audiences of Chennai. If we are performing in Punjab, we will also alter and think, oh, this works well for a Punjab audience. It is similar in those times that with the patronage, the performance structure used to be varied,
especially,
but not the art.
Especially in Wajid Ali Shah's time, when yes, he actually influenced Kathak to such a great degree.
In my research, what I found was that Wajid Ali Shah actually brought choreography into Kathak. Before that, Kathak was a solo performing art. All dancers were solo performers and they performed, you know, individually.
It was Wajid Ali Shah who started all these ras. He wrote these, what should I say, Nritya Natika dance dramas that we call today. And he actually performed them with his fairies, as he liked to call them. So he enacted this whole dramatic representation of a Kathak dance form, which again, it existed. It's not as if Wajid Ali Shah created Kathak dance form. It existed in the Indian subcontinent. And we have been influenced by whoever has ruled us, but influenced to an extent, but we have also retained our own authenticity back into it. So yes, there was a lot of Persian element that came into Kathak, which was largely Mughal driven because of the times that it was performed in. And it changed a kind of a structure in the performance art, not in the grammar.
Shubhaji, first of all, everybody's dying to hear your voice, so we must have you speak right away. When did you start getting aware that the Tawaf culture, which had done so much to contribute to arts in India, was somehow being marginalized? When did you start feeling that? At the start of your career or later, or how did you get interested in the subject?
Well, I must confess that I am not somebody who has been focusing only on the art of the Tawaifs. But as a student of Hindustani music, naturally I came across, I mean, it would be absolutely impossible to be a student of Hindustani music and not have heard and been influenced and admired the voices of the great women singers of the past, particularly those who adapted to recording technology when it came to India in the early 20th century. And so listening to the recordings of great singers like Gauhar Jan, Janki Bai, and the list is, in fact, one of the great collectors of this music, Dr. Chanmankar, he just sent us this huge list of all the women performers, and it runs into several pages. So as a student of Hindustani music, it would be impossible for me not to have heard them. And my first response as a student of music is just to say, wow, I mean, those voices speak to you. Today, we are learning to become singers for a microphone culture, for amplified concerts. Here were ladies who were performing in a jalsa and with no amplification, and then adapting their voices and their music for recording technology. So they were consummate artists, many of them, excellent people, excellent musicians who left these recordings for us to study and to understand many, many aspects of music making. I think it's also important to say here that, you know, the subject of courtesan culture and the music of the courtesans has been largely viewed from two main angles. One is to say that everything that belonged to the courtesan culture was wonderful and that they have not been given their due. Certainly, the social stigma attached to them definitely cannot be ignored. The other is to romanticize it to a point where we think that just by taking some, you know, some of their ahar, how they dressed, how they perhaps appeared in a performance, that is enough to understand courtesan culture. I think all of these aspects are important, significant. Understanding the mujra also cannot be, it's not just a performance of the courtesan. The word mujra itself actually also has other connotations. For example, one of the connotations is when you enter a space where there is somebody whom you hold in high esteem and you do a salam to them. That is also mujra.
That was also
lena.
Called mujra.
Yes. You know, and so perhaps one of the things that happened in the mujra was to give a salami to the patrons. True. Perhaps that is why one of the reasons. But for me, my first interaction with the music of the Tawaifs came as a student of music. And it was slowly that I saw that and read that there was a great unjust, unreasonable stigma attached to them. And as I grew up and as I continued to think about this, I would also like to place on record the fact that, and unfortunately, despite the fact that today people like first generation artists like you and me are being held in great respect and esteem, but our society is such that it does not value arts and artists. It is very easy in our society to run down an artist, male or female. And unfortunately, if you're female, there are other connotations that can be added to the many, many unfortunate things that are said about artists. After all, every policymaker across political parties just derides us saying nachne gaane wale. It doesn't bother them that they can take the nachne gaane wale to get tickets because they are people in the public gaze. That's very easy. But when it comes to running them down, ye to nachne gaane wale, inko kyun award mil raha hai? Inko kyun importance mil rahi hai? So unfortunately, society has not looked at arts and artists with due respect. Yet, despite that, some great musicians, including those from the Tawaif culture, from the Tawaif tradition, have risen to great heights because of their work.
Did you have the opportunity of knowing any of the Tawaifs while you were a young student?
Yes.
Did you meet any? Can you tell the audience what kind of people they were in real life?
So I'm hesitant to say this because of all the laughter that will go around in the auditorium. But as I grew up, as a four-year-old, I started learning Kathak Manjari.
Yes, we read about
and I learned
that
for several years. And so no laughing, huh?
No one's laughing.
No, and I have to tell you that once when she was asked which gharana of Kathak does she practice and belong to, she said, I belong to my own gharana and my own practice.
Well, you can only say that when you're ignorant and four-year-old and get away with it. Otherwise, there would be too many questions asked. But yes, I started learning Kathak and I learned for several years. I learned in the Jaipur style and in Allahabad, which was my hometown. And where I met a young woman, a little older than me, who came with two older women. And I could see from the manner in which everybody interacted with them that there was almost a slight, you know, smile on everyone's faces. You know, they're from that tradition. And that's when I became aware, because the young woman who was learning with me danced like a dream and was very tayar also. And yet there was something in the way that everybody in their interaction that seemed not to be too respectful. And so I have personally interacted with women from that tradition, but also one of my great teachers, Srimati Naina Devi Ji, she did a lot of work with Tawaifs in the Delhi area, and very often she would talk about that, tell us about her interactions, and also, in fact, play some recordings that she had made at home, you know, while talking to them. So that's how my personal sort of association with them, in a sense, interaction with them, happened.
Thank you. Manjuri Ji, you must tell us about the flamboyance of these ladies, how they were economically independent. Right now, we are seeing them through the gaze of history, where they have been marginalized, they have been treated not with the kind of dignity that they deserved. But recount their glory days.
It's a huge, long answer, if I may say. But we have covered a section of, you know, their being the highest taxpayers and, you know, their being very wealthy women, as recorded by Britishers in the first session when Dr. Veena Oldenburg discussed about the Gazette from the Britishers that she had went across. So we already established that they were, you know, and after that, Yatin Ji said that, you know, they were the wealthy women of those times.
They, in fact, played a very significant part in the uprising in 1857.
Yes, they did, and subsequent freedom struggle too, because they gave away a lot of their money. The kotas were the places where most of the freedom fighters hid. They kept their all their arms and ammunition. They hid them in the kotas. So they played a very strong role in the freedom movement. But again, we don't accord them that status. We don't. They are not part of any freedom struggles studies that we as students talk about. Between 1857 to 1947, we don't talk about it because the wives were not important. We don't know about Azizan Bai, who fought against the Britishers in Kanpur. So these are because they were women of, according to us, women of low character. So we did not accord them that. But you know, if we see as a performance art and we talk about their glory, yes, there was a certain, you see, we all haven't seen the Tawaif that existed when we talk about the 18th century or 19th century. The only thing that we have are the paintings that the Britishers made and some photographs in the later stage that we have. Now, if we talk about their, can we have some images of the Tawaifs, please, on the screen, just for reference? So some of the images that I found in my archival with Sri Pran Neville from his book, The Notch Girls of India. And if you see that, you know, their outfits are really royal outfits.
Covered so, from head to toe.
And you know, the one major issue that I always bring up is that I don't understand from where that cleavage showing tight outfit of a Tawaif has come and stuck in our minds and we say Tawaif wore that. None of these archival images that you will see have any part of the Tawaif's body shown except for the face and hands and feet. They're covered from head to toe, either in a sari where they're singing or in a peshwas when they're dancing. So the elaborate dress, now what comes to my mind is that I did not see a Tawaif how she performed. But when I see these images, I recreate those outfits when I perform. Because for me, that becomes the true representation. Now, so that might be elaborate if we see in terms of today's outfits. But I guess it represents an era in which they lived.
But they were also seen to be women of high learning, of great culture, of great etiquette. The sons of nobility were sent to them to pick up, ways of being and talking. And so tell us about what contributed to them being women of such learning and,
If I may say that, you know, at that point of time, see, if you see, you compare the status of women generally in the society with these women, and you see the difference, because generally the women were what? See, they were married. They were married off at a very early age. They were largely confined to home. They were homemakers.
You're talking about non-Tawaif.
Non-Tawaifs. Yes. I'm just talking about a general society. Mm. And the elite class, if it was the Nawabs or the Rajas, irrespective of their religion, they all had, 200, 300, 100 wives. So they all had their harem. Now we are talking about that society. We are not talking about today's society. And in that society, there was this one woman who had her art. And if we are saying that, she was only supposed to look pretty, and trust me, all the pictures that we've seen, none of the Tawaifs look like Rekha or Meena Kumari. They were very ordinary women, ordinary looking. They had their art. The art appealed to people. And they were not fools. Shubhaji is there, I'm there. For an artist to be able to perform, a minimum of 10 to 12 years is needed as rigorous practice. And that too in the prime of your youth. Now if these women were only supposed to look pretty and for body show, were they fools to practice 10 hours every day for 10 years to excel in an art? We can't, we can't just ridicule them for the fact that they were women. So this, they were of a high society, but I would want, for one thing that, I always think that this statement when we say that the nobility, the boys of the noble families were sent to the Tawaifs to learn etiquettes, over the years, I have felt that there's something very, again, there's unjust. There's a snigger in it that, because maybe they went for sexual favors. Because why would they go? Now, I feel that was there no tehzeeb in the household of the Nawabs? Unke ghar mein tehzeeb nahi thi
ki unko
tawaif ke paas bhejna tha. Achha, agar tawaif ke paas apne bete ko bhejna tha, to bete ko bhi bhejte bhai. Because भाई तहजीब की ठेकेदार तो औरत होती है, तो आप अपनी बेटियों को भी भेजते फिर तहजीब सीखने तवायफ के पास. सो समवेयर दिस स्टेटमेंट आल्सो मोस्ट ऑफ द टाइम कम्स विद अ अंडरहैंडेड स्टेटमेंट अबाउट यू नो एनी समथिंग टू डू विद सेक्सुअलिटी. वन थिंग विच आई ओवर द इयर्स व्हेन आई स्पोक टू पीपल अबाउट द तवायफ कल्चर केम विच वॉज वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग वॉज दैट देर वॉज नो अपॉर्चुनिटी ऑफ अ मेल फीमेल कॉन्वर्सेशन. So some of the people actually told me that their grandfathers used to just go to the kota, have a conversation, come back. They actually never had any relationship with the tawaf, which was very interesting because see that again that society where you're not even allowed to see your brother's wife. Everybody is in a parda. You don't know how to behave in front of a woman. You don't backslap and talk when you're in front of a woman. Today we can't think of those things because we live in a society where men and women are all together. And we know how we are behaving when we are in front of five women and when we are alone with five men. In those times, that was the only opportunity for them to have a conversation with a woman and an intelligent woman. So if you talked about politics, she would come back and have a view on politics. If you said koi sher padha, to uspe wo dusra sher sunayegi. Aapne usse koi पैसे की या कुछ और इस चीज़ की बात करी तो उस पर भी उसका ओपिनियन होगा बिकॉज शी इज़ अर्निंग हर सेल्फ सो शी नोज वॉट मनी इज. एंड अनदर वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग आस्पेक्ट इज मैन लव टू गॉसिप. सो द कोठा एक्चुअली बिकेम अ गॉसिप सेंटर फॉर देम बिकॉज शी कुड टेल डिफरेंट गॉसिप्स अबाउट डिफरेंट अदर एस्टेट्स अदर किंग्स अदर नोबिलिटी. सो इट बिकेम अ वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग कॉन्वर्सेशन एंड दिस आई फाउंड मोस्ट इंटरेस्टिंग अबाउट द होल रिसर्च एंड अबाउट एवरीबडी सेइंग दैट देयर वर दीज अवेलेबल वुमेन. नो देयर वर इंटेलिजेंट वुमेन विद अ कॉन्वर्सेशन टू.
आई थिंक टू थिंग्स दैट बेग मेंशनिंग राइट हियर इज फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल द एलिफेंट इन द रूम इज द मेल गेज एंड हाउ इट impacted women performers, especially the tawaifs. And the second thing is the British Puritanism that perhaps finally was the last nail in the coffin that did them in. Shubhaji, would you be able to talk about the male gaze? And perhaps in the field of singing, it is not, you know, you can close your eyes and listen to a voice and it doesn't really have to be a gender specific. But basically, what do you think about the courtesan and her and the impact of the male gaze on the art form?
Interestingly, a lot of the composers in this tradition of Hindustani music have been males also. For example, I mean, there have been women composers, but a large number have been male composers, and it's interesting that they choose a feminine voice to write in. There are few compositions which are written from the point of view of, let's say, a male pining for a woman. You will find exceptions, but largely it won't be that.
It won't
and
be.
Therefore, compositions that were made for the tawaifs, of course, ranged from a wide variety. There were compositions which were given to them by gharanedar ustads, whom they engaged as tutors. And so they inherited compositions of those gharanas. Many of them were, of course, of a religious, sort of a mystical nature also. Others had a Shringarik quality to them. There were some that could, today perhaps if you translate them into English, they would definitely be called bawdy or, you know, marked as explicit on iTunes or something like that. But I think that the women as musicians, the tawaifs as musicians, really inherited and also added to this great corpus of compositions, bringing to them their own understanding of the music, their own life experiences, and very often, perhaps, especially in the Thumri tradition, where seasonal song forms also became a part of the Thumri tradition. Women coming from different parts of India perhaps brought in the folk music of that area, the sahitya, the dohas, the shairs that were perhaps popular in those regions. So they added to that tradition. And of course, most of this material was supposed written by males, for the male gaze. Having said that, fortunately, because the power and strength of music is such, and the power and strength of great music in particular is such that it transcends. Mm. So even if you're speaking of the male gaze in performance, the text and the music itself could be multi-layered. So you could say that Atariya pe khade ho gaye badnam. But the Atariya could be treated, you know, as a multi-layered text, and it could also mean reaching a kind of a spiritual mm-hmm. space. So I think that tradition has been very much a part of Indian arts and also the music of the Tawaifs, mm-hmm. even though it was perhaps created by males for the male gaze, even then this work transcended all.
What about in the field of dance? There would definitely be a slightly different nuance to the question.
See, if we see that time, the time that when these performers were performing was largely, if we see Hindi Sahitya, it was Riti Kal. Now, Riti Kal was largely a time when romantic poetry was written. So first of all, we can't blame the artists for the time that they were living in and the kind of poetry that was being written at that point of time. They were singing the poetry that was largely written at that time, which involved a lot of romance. Now, when we talk about a male gaze, this actually what happens is that the history documented for us is very patriarchy.
Yes, yeah.
It's written by patriarchy, it's very patriarchal, so it's a patriarchal point of view. There have been very few women who have documented history. So now today the history that we have is a patriarchal view of everything. So I am a performer. My performance art says that if I'm performing today, aaj jaane ki zidna karo, I'm using a very simple composition, very simple line. Each one in this audience should feel as if I am saying it to them, whether it's a man or a woman. Now, so that's my art. My art requires me to create that rasa in you so that you feel I'm just singing it I'm just dancing it for you. That's what my art says. Now, if you as an audience, and see, we are talking again about a time where the zanana and mardana were different. There was no possibility of a man and a woman sitting together and watching a performance. Either there was a performance for all male audience, or it was a performance for an all female audience. So again, we can't blame those women for
and
the time
they lived
in.
There were no records or diaries or memoirs written by women who were in
very
the audience?
Few. Not in the audience, but very few written by the Tawaifs themselves. And that actually gives us an insight into the few things that we would like to know. So if I come back to the performance art, so now it's my job as a performer to create that rasa in you, for you to feel that I'm saying it for you. Now, if it's a man documenting, he would document, oh, she had beautiful eyes, the move of her waist was such, the way she looked into me and she said, and I felt as if she was saying it for me. So that is something which he is witnessing himself as a rasa of art.
Isn't that stereotyping? Isn't that stereotyping the men also?
No, but I'm just saying that it is a huge possibility of this happening, because we don't know what that woman felt when she was performing. We have no records, almost no records, of the aspect about the woman, why she performed a certain composition, why she enjoyed performing a certain composition vis-a-vis 100 others being possibly there. So there was no...
Shubhaji, you can throw some light on this. When you are performing, what goes through your mind and how, who are you singing to? Are you singing for yourself? Are you singing for the character whose words you are conveying?
I think it's very difficult to give a formulaic answer to this question, particularly because I am a student of Hindustani classical music, which very often is non-representational. So, in fact, one of the strengths of the music, I feel, is that I may be giving an interpretation of a rag, I may be rendering an interpretation of a rag, depending on my talim, my training, my own understanding, my cultural associations with that particular rag, etc., etc. But the person who's receiving that may give an entirely different interpretation. Yes. And I'll give you a common example, a very simple example. For example, we are taught that the malhars are sung during the rains. And we grow up without even questioning that. What about the malhars is there? What about the phrasing of the music? Mm. Suggests rain. Because we also do very, very elaborate alap in malhars. So it's not as if it's a rush of, or a burst of notes which is like, you know, raindrops. Mm. It isn't like that. We do wonderful meer alaps as well. We do behlava. We use a variety of musical devices, some of which would not suggest rain to anybody. So this is an association that is clearly linked with the subcontinent and the culture and the...
It's a contextual thing.
Yeah, it's really a context that we relate to. Somebody else from another system of music may actually say that if I'm singing Bilawal, they may see a rush of notes which suggests rain to them. So I think, you know, these are very complex issues, and simplifying them to say that when I sing, let's say, a tumri, I start seeing Krishna, that doesn't happen every day. A combination of things, a combination of various aspects work in a strange chemistry that really can't be perhaps articulated very clearly. The same composition sung on different days may create a different impact, both for me as well as for the listeners. And heaven help me if it's a bad day, then I could be really doing some serious damage to the listeners. But I think these are very, very complex aesthetic issues, which you can't really say that 20% of ragdari, 35% of sahitya, mythological imagery, I don't think it's possible to really put it down like that for me.
True.
But it's a combination of these things, and it's a combination of your understanding of sound, rag, sahitya, tal, etc., that finally creates that canvas, that oral canvas that you render before an audience.
True. We've spoken about the male gaze, we've briefly talked about how British imperialism and the puritanical, you know, movement has contributed to the decline of the Tawaifs. What we've not talked about is the perhaps politicizing of the Tawaif culture, which mainly belonged to the Muslim communities of this country, though of course there were some Hindu women who converted into Islam to become Tawaifs. But can you shed some light on perhaps in the recent past whether there has been a deliberate attempt to marginalize them further? What would you say?
I don't think so that it is based on religion at all. Because the Tawaifs and Baijis were both Hindu and Muslim run. So it's not something that is religion specific. It's something which, if I may say, is, if we see in recent time, it's stigma specific because based on gender largely. One aspect that did, surface in this, if I may be, I don't know if I'm incorrect in saying that, and if it is, then I would happily stand corrected if somebody does that, is that, you know, post-independence, there was a certain, you know, Brahminical hold on music and dance, and there was a huge cleaning that happened. It seems like that, because, you know, there were a lot of, for example, during my research, I found that there was a very popular song at that time, which was Lagat Karijwa Ma Chot. Phul Gindwa Namaro, Lagat Karijwa Ma Chot. Now that song actually was originally, I came to know that song was Phul Gindwa Namaro, Lagat Jobanwa Ma Chot. Now somewhere we did not find the word Joban correct, whereas I find that you know, in other songs, the word Joban does come up. Amir Khusro's song does have Mora Jobana Navelara, and I was taught that as a Kathak dancer. So somewhere in some portions we've sanitized that word, in some portions we have kept that word. So somewhere I actually don't find a conclusive answer of any think, which is, if I may say, as religion specific, or this whole of Brahminical aspect specific. But yes, gender specific, I do find it in all this study.
Well, some of the Tawaifs are said to have converted to Islam, because Islam says that every person must be given a decent burial. And so the last rites were promised to them with dignity. That is why it is said that some of the Tawaifs...
That's a very nice perspective, yeah, I didn't know that. Yeah.
That is one of the things we have heard, that perhaps some of them converted because they wanted, when they passed away, a decent, dignified burial.
But you mean otherwise they would not have been...
Possibly. Possibly.
See, Yatinji just mentioned in his talk that even and we are not. See, don't go back. It's you and me. We are the society that is there. Nobody else. That post independence at the All India Radio, the Baijis were asked to, the unmarried Baijis, by the way, were asked to go from the back door and make a recording, and only the ustads were allowed to come from the front door. The fact was that now I feel that, you know, why did you even record the Baijis if you were so, you didn't want that stigma? But the fact was that their records and their songs sold more. So the AIR wanted them. So ek backdoor entrance, aur dusra ki aapko pehle shaadi karni padegi tab hum aapko record karenge. Now these are bizarre things. So maybe what Shubhaji is saying, and this is a new perspective that I've come to know today about their changing their religion. But yes, a lot of them converted to Islam. That's a given fact. And over the years, we did read about this.
Would you talk about the contribution of women like the reformists or the cultural reformists of the 19th century and the early 20th? Rukmini Devi, people even like Tagore, who rescued our arts, especially our performing arts, from this stigmatization which the British had, some of them like Bharatnatyam, which Rukmini Devi then brought into the high citadels of learning. Would you like to talk about their contribution, and then more recent ones of Kumudini Ben Lakhia and Maya Rao and people? But first, the early reformists of culture in India.
The irony is that the reformist had to actually save the art from ourselves. Mm. It wasn't as if they had to save it from somebody else. So it was we ourselves, and our own reformers were coming and saving our own art. So it's a bizarre thing when you come to think of it, that, you know, why was this happening? Again, why did, this whole process, if I may say, of Rukmini Devi ji did exemplary work in her times to create a dance form. But if I may say that, what was that dance form? That was actually the dance that the Devdasis did. Though again, I would put it on record that my subject is not on Devdasis. But since a question has been addressed, we'll just try and address it to the best of my knowledge. That so the dance was taken from the Devdasis, brought into a sanitized format, and is it that if the Brahminical girls started performing it, you made it respectable for people? Why was it so wrong when the Devdasis were performing the same art?
But
so
because she brought it out,
yes,
but then popularized.
Yes. Maybe the timing was right to bring it in that format. And if I may say, there were a lot of things that I find in Kathak also. Today, if you see a Kathak performance, it's a very... grammar-oriented performance with a group dance, with a group structure happening. There are two aspects. There's a single solo performer also, and there's a group structure. And if there's a performance, then it's largely attributed to Lord Krishna. So it's become a... Because somewhere we are very comfortable the moment we bring in bhakti element to it. It just brings us to a very... comfort zone, that we are singing it for bhakti or we are dancing for bhakti. Now the similar things, if I may say, that the what did the Tawaifs do? They talked about romance. Why is something that a romance between a man and woman is so wrong, but when it is said for a human and a god, it's absolutely right? where in the world have we reached as a society that today we have to justify these things? Our society was so forward that we have the stories of Krishna and Radha both not married to each other, both married to two different people.
They are our epitome of love. Yeah.
So we are a society that was so comfortable with it. Where have we reached that we are questioning these things, that if it is bhakti, it is okay. If it is romance between a man and a woman, oh, it's uncomfortable for us.
But would you say that that came because of a certain Western sensibility that we underwent?
I think those were times when there was this kind of cultural nationalism, and there was an attempt, for example, to recreate a beautiful, majestic past. Having said that, I think it's very difficult for me to say that all attempts to, let's say, what is called sanitizing, I'm not sure that it was, it came with this kind of evangelist spirit. A lot of people like, let's say, Vishnu Digambar Paluskarji were setting up institutions for music where they were introducing for the first time women who came from not from the families of...
Not hereditary families.
They were able to get an opportunity to study music. Children were being taught music. And a connect was being made with a sort of an ancient, glorious past. Perhaps it would be unfair to say that when Vishnu Digambar Paluskarji started introducing chopais from the Ramayana, other poetry which was bhakti-purna in its nature, that he was sanitizing the entire system or cleansing it completely. Perhaps, sometimes when I look at a child in a talent contest today, singing the most raunchy song and everybody saying, wow, fantastic. And there is this child wriggling and winking and, singing
and
something.
Perhaps not even knowing what
yes,
it all implies.
Exactly. And I'm worried. I mean, what's happening? I'm not saying that every child should be singing nursery rhymes alone. But I'm saying it makes me uncomfortable. Perhaps when Vishnu Digambar Paluskarji thought that let me open this world of Hindustani music to so many other people who have not had the chance, maybe he thought maybe this is not a great composition. Chalo mitwa balam rangraliyan kare, or something like that. Chalo mitwa balam bhagwa ham tum piye madwa kare rangraliyan. Let us not have this 10-year or 6-year old child sing this without knowing what the sahitya means. So I think perhaps, these things have to be. Vishnu Digambar ji is no longer there to answer our questions. But to say that it is all being cleansed, perhaps we need to look at this in a nuanced way.
Yes.
And not in a black and white kind of understanding.
Manjuri, what would you say your foundation, what is your foundation's biggest achievement now? You've been working 7 years. Tell us a little about some of the artists that you have supported, some of the what has been the trajectory.
That is something that it's an ongoing process, but the biggest achievement today is that we are sitting here and talking about the Tavayavs, and we are ready to have a conversation. We are not doing a drawing room conversation with negative connotations associated with it, and a winking of an eye and saying that, oh, she must have had an affair with somebody. So we are sitting here and discussing their art. We are trying to understand why the times changed. So to bring this has been the, if I may say, in today's time, with all the fact that if I very briefly share with you, the first time that I went and I went asking for sponsorship for a concert for Zarina Begum, and I went to a couple of people, and I'd already been performing for 15 years and I had sponsors who sponsored my shows. And one gentleman very nicely turned around and said in Delhi, and turned around and said, "Wo Manjuri ji, aap jo apne shows karti hain, usme ek brand association acha banta hai. Ab ye zamana gaya, main tawaifon ko honor kare." And it just struck me, I'm a dancer sitting across the table. Just because I'm articulate, I can speak English, I come from a privileged background, you won't say the word nachne wali to me, but in effect, inside, you actually mean that. So that's why you're not ready to support a program for the Vaif, but you're ready to support a program of Manjari. So that
when did
is
the stigma start? How did, you know, what? When exactly? Was it post 1857,
yes,
when they were called Nachne Gane Walis by the British because of tax purposes? When did it start getting downhill?
It looks like around that time, especially during the British period, because they put, see, even today, if I may say, we have entertainment section, and if I explain in terms of cinema, if I take away from the classical forms just now, because we are talking about entertainment, and that's what the Britishers put all the performers into. So we have the A-grade films, we have the B-grade films, we have the C-grade films, we have the pornographic films. We don't club the artists of a C-grade film with an A-grade film artist, because they are catering to a very different forms of entertainment. At that time also, they were similar. They were Bhand, they were Nakal, they were Mirasins, they were Tawaifs. But Tawaifs and Baijis were the highest form of entertainment as of whatever I found during my research. So it is unfair to put them into that whole bracket of, you know, prostitution, which they were largely not. Like I said, they worked hard for 10, 12 years, 15 years to practice an art. We can't put them at par with, you know, sex workers. And that's what interchangeably we've been doing. And before that, if we go back, like I went to Hyderabad, and there's a place, even you can go and see there, there's a place called Seven Tombs. That's where the royalty of the Quli Qutub Shah dynasty is buried. So within that compound where the royalty is buried is where the court dancers are buried. So they were at par with the royalty. Mahalakka Bai Chanda was called the Umrah, which is the royalty. So she was a court dancer. So we see that during that time, they held a place of great respect.
Shubhaji, would you call, can you enumerate the contribution of women like Gohar Jan and Janki Bai to the tradition of music and recording in this country?
Well, these were artists of great eminence, and who became extremely popular, also commanded great respect, first because of their brilliance as artists, but also as women who had great wealth. And Gohar Jan, of course, there are many anecdotes of how she was quite defiant and lived life on her own terms, down to the point of being ready to pay fines for riding in a buggy. In a buggy, despite.
Why don't you tell the audience that?
At that point in Calcutta, I'm told that it was not possible for ordinary citizens to ride a buggy,
six-horse-drawn
buggy, and she insisted on doing that. A fine was levied on her, but she chose to pay the fine and still defy the order. So I think these were women who'd commanded great respect because of their artistry. They looked at the music. She was able to sing a wide variety of forms, ranging from khayal to thumri, kajri. She sang in several languages. Also, I think there is a recording of her having sung at the Darbar Hall at the Asiatic,
yes,
where she thanks many people, the people of Mumbai who you know, helped her. And similarly, Janki Bai, of course, was also another among the very eminent singers of the Tawaif tradition who were also recorded. She came from Allahabad. Again, there was a large variety that she too sang, perhaps not in as many languages, or at least we don't have those recordings, not as many languages as Gohar Jan sang in, but again, a woman of great artistic excellence. And yet, Gohar Jan's end was not a very happy one. She was in Mysore when she died. And I think, in a sense, for me, these two ladies sort of tell a story of the struggles of an artist both in terms of how they are treated by society and their stature and status in society, as well as the inner struggle of an artist and the high tide of popularity and the loneliness when that is on the wane. I think these are universal stories of many, many artists. And for me, perhaps because I grew up in a family of very wonderful, strong men and women, all of whom really respected each other, perhaps I think for me these are artist icons, you know, rather than Tawaifs. But that's just me. And I can understand that, you know, there must have been challenges which perhaps Manjari and I will not even be able to assess and understand because we do not come from that milieu.
Yes, if I may say, Shubhaji, I was told this in the Delhi seminar when we did this, and there was one lady who came up to me. She refused to tell me her name, and she came and she told me कि आप स्टेज पर बैठकर तवायफों की बात इसलिए कर रही हैं क्योंकि आप तवायफ की बेटी नहीं हैं. अगर आप तवायफ की बेटी होती तो शर्म से घर पे बैठी होती. And that was such a statement. She refused to tell me her name. I said, please give me your introduction. And I said, no, but that is what we are talking. Why should one be ashamed? She said, आज आप देखकर देखिए कोई आपको नहीं बताएगा कि वो तवायफ की बेटी है या ग्रैंड डॉटर है क्योंकि वो शर्मसार है. And I felt so bad. That, you know, like Shubhaji said, we both come from families. We are privileged. We have a certain sense of privilege with us. But then I feel that then it gives me all the more responsibility to talk about it.
Which is why what you're doing is so commendable, really. I'm fascinated by how the Tawaf tradition flourished when, even while there was a patriarchal Ustad tradition simultaneously, how did these women foster, nurture their communities, hand down this oral tradition? Can you shed some light about that? And what did it take for them to keep it alive generation to generation?
Well, I think, their desire to learn from the male ustads really made them, in a sense, they went as students, and in our tradition, the disciple, certainly the hierarchy of the hierarchical status of the disciple is certainly lower than the guru. Yes. But they were able to engage their services by paying them a fee that very often was considered very high in the times. And apart from that, I'm also told that many of the Tawaifs also arranged for jalsas and for special chamber concerts where an artist who was visiting a city for the first time would perform before peers and before elders. And if they really proved their mark there, then the patrons would hear about this visiting artist and find more concert engagements. So in a sense, they were also becoming promoters of the art. And I think for an artist to do that is quite difficult because they themselves are performing artists. So then for them to become promoters of other extremely talented people may have perhaps caused a conflict of interest.
And in the same context, one hears about how the Tawaifs were the people who the great poets would try and woo so that they would sing their
kalam, yes.
Yes, their yes. compositions.
Yeah, because in a sense it would become immortalized if they sang them, if they recorded those pieces.
Manjari,
that actually was something that I found most interesting was that, and when I see it in today's context, it makes it more feasible, is that today if you see, Hindustan mein 1000 shayar to honge, kam se kam. But who do we know? We know
Gulzar Saab,
we know Prasoon. Why do we know them? Because Bollywood sings them. Aur koi shayar hum jante nahi hai. So it was similar if we go back in those times. The poets actually aspired for the Tawaif to sing them. Because if the Tawaif sings them, they become very famous.
And they so heard Begum in the courts ke liye of kings.
Hai. Yeah, Begum Akhtar ke liye kehte hai ki Begum Saab ne kitno ko shayar bana diya. Unhone shayar nahi bana diya. But because she sang, they became very famous. And I came across, when I was going through the research, I came across letters of Mirza Ghalib. One of his letters to the Rampur Nawab, he actually writes a shayari and he sends it to Rampur Nawab and is asking the Nawab to ask one of the tawaifs of his court to sing, because they had the best of the tawaifs in Rampur. It was a very very good court that patronized very good artists. So the desire for Mirza Ghalib for his poetry to be sung by a tawaif, it actually in that letter tells us that.
So in a way, they were that era's agency, like Bollywood is this year's. Yes. I mean, this era's. Last thing before we open it up for questions is, it was very interesting for me to see that a lot of the tawaifs feel that Umrao Jaan, the book, and then the film, did a lot of damage to their culture and their traditions. What would you say about that?
See, I won't say damage per se, but I feel that, you know, we attribute a lot to Bollywood, but the fact is that Bollywood is an entertainment industry. It is supposed to entertain you with stories. The problem with us is that we are giving Bollywood the responsibility of documentation, which is not their responsibility. So what we have started thinking, that whatever Bollywood showed us as tawaifs is the documentation. No, Bollywood has a different medium. It is supposed to entertain
and
you.
And which is why discussions like this,
yes,
are attempting to change that narrative.
Yes, and we should know the other narrative, which is not necessarily given in an entertainment, TRP or ticket sale driven kind of a medium.
I think we can open this out to questions. I see one, a lady there. Sangeeta, is that you? Okay, please.
Hi, this has been a very, very interesting conversation. I had two questions, actually. First, is there a lot of metaphors that seem to come from even Indian painting, which are erotic, and which we may have heard in Thumris or in sort of Kathak, or even contemporary entertainment, like, to give you an example, Dr. B.K. Goswami had done a presentation on Indian art, and there was this idea of the Nayika stretching her limbs and yawning, which I don't know why is considered to be erotic. So you take a song like Kajrare, and you have Aishwarya saying, Meri angrai na tute to aja. I was very fascinated by the connection to painting and metaphors that we see in entertainment or thumri or this sort of music, dance music. And the second question, if I may ask, or should I wait?
Who would you like to address, whoever
may have come across the metaphor.
Okay.
You're talking about the specific
the erotic metaphors from painting into music.
I think, you know, there are many instances where painting and music and poetry have gone hand in hand. And you will see that, for example, the blossoming of spring, the kind of rejuvenation, the kind of sort of welling of youth that is seen in painting is often also expressed in Thumri compositions, which talk about Jobanwa, which she mentioned, and in specific, and more specifically, if you look at the erotic angle, the welling, the kind of reference to the breasts of a woman. This is very, very common, and you find it both in painting, you find it in poetry, and sometimes it's veiled. I know I've learned Dadra, Janya Tore Joban Madmate. And so, you know, I think they were sung without the kind of rules of censorship. They were painted without the kind of rules of censorship that today are either enforced or ignored when it suits everybody, or, for example, raked up and turned into a violent protest when it suits other people. So I think we were looking at a society that certainly was not not censoring in the manner that we see censorship today.
Today, and also for you.
So if I may just add on to a bit. As my personal experiences, I was working on a project which is called the Vrindavan Project, and it explores the love between Krishna and Radha. So for a reference, I was sent a set of paintings as Radha's outfit. And trust me, the outfit that Radha is wearing in those paintings, today I cannot wear it on stage. Mm.
you know, the kind of midriff showing, the kind of half breast showing through the blouse. And I said, you know, this is the imagery that was created for Radha and Krishna in those miniature paintings. But today, we cannot recreate that on stage because, like Shubhaji said, we are living in a world where we have chosen censorship, we have a varied sense of sensuality, we have varied levels of understanding. So it's something which obviously the arts take from one another, but not necessarily every time.
Another question.
Can we go to? Yeah, I had one more. But if
okay, let's go to the gentleman on. Yes, there. We'll try and come back to you, but let's give somebody else a chance.
It has been fascinating listening about tawaifs. I was just wondering, you see tawaifs in the Bollywood context and the way they show it, a lot of musicians sit with them. Do we know what happened to them, or have some of them risen from just being a tawaifs musicians in the gharana to becoming truly musicians on their own?
Several musicians were performing with the tawaifs as well, and they are musicians of great eminence. More recently, I don't know of, I mean, let's say in the last 20 years, I don't know of musicians who have been performing with tawaifs, because tawaif culture itself and the idea of, there being musicians practicing Hindustani music, Tumri Dadra, etc., has been completely almost on the decline. So I don't know in the recent past, but many eminent musicians performed with the tawaifs and became great iconic musicians as well.
Manjuri ji, you can answer that, and then we'll have to wrap this up.
Shubhaji's already answered that, so I don't think there's anything to add.
Okay, then one last question. The gentleman here, yeah. Short question and short answer. Yeah.
Manjuri ji, you were mentioning about some tawaifs in your research. You came across some books written by them or some of their memoir, kind of. How could we read, or could you guide us on how to?
Yes, that is something that I actually want to do. And there was another lady who had also asked about books on tawaifs and not being available. We are actually making a list of it, and we'll work that out. For the moment, I'll tell you, there are only two tawaifs whose records we found. One is by Mahalakka Bai Chanda in Hyderabad. And you could find her letters, which are generally her letters to her mother, in which she has explained her life. And very interesting one thing that, you know, all this, with that I very quickly tell you, that, you know, this whole concept that Bollywood has told us about redemption of a woman, this tawaif who needs to get married to a man who will save her from this tawaif culture. Actually, Mahalakka Bai Chanda in her letter writes that to her mother that I don't want to be married. I don't want to be part of somebody's harem. I'm an individual woman. I earn money. I have my dance, I have my music, I dance and sing when I want to, I don't want to get married. So it gives an insight into that woman that we all want, we all think of a Pakiza kind of a thing, ki wo bichari aurat jisko shaadi honi thi, jisko wo aadmi aana tha, jo usko save karega, but this is all that patriarchal setup. And the other that you would find also is Mudupulani's book, which is, I think, by Penguin. That's also the perspective of she's a Devdasi, but similar perspective.
And Pran Neville's book has so much.
Pran Neville's book, that is an incredible book because it covers the Notch girls from, a real, I would say, from the Apsaras to, you know, to the modern times. He was the only man who had actually seen the Kotas pre-independence and post-independence. The mehfils that Shubhaji referred to as Naina Devi's houses, which the recordings she must have shared in 1955. I heard those recordings. They were in presence of Pran Neville himself.
Yeah, and there's Ye Kothe Waliyan by Amritlal Nagar. There's also Diwane Janki, which Janki Bai herself wrote, but those are her poems. Unfortunately, that is no longer in print. I don't know where you could find a copy, perhaps in some library, but that also is there.
Malka Jan's poems are also there, which I've been requesting British Museum to give it to me for last 8 or 9 months. I still haven't got.
Thank you, Shubhaji, so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Manjuri ji.
Thank you.